Hey, I'm Mac. Right now, I just want to do a really quick stream just to capture this on video. I'm going to prepare these parts for 3D printing. So currently I have these in two separate bodies because they'll be two separate halves. And there are a couple of reasons why I want to do it that way, because you know, a lot of my parts have a lot of surface detail, like all these rivets and stuff. So if I orientate them in certain ways, I end up having to place little supports on every single one of the rivets. So I am trying to avoid that by orientating them and splitting this into two pieces. And it also helps me because I think it helps assembly later on. Okay. So the first thing is save as STL on each of the bodies. So far, I think the Fusion 360's STL is working great, so we'll leave that as that. Okay. And then I'll save this as STL. So this is going to be printed on my Moai Peopoly, and I'm just using this to capture what is the software steps that needs to go through. Okay, so that's that. So I'm gonna get out of Fusion. Alright, that looks like it's saving. Alright, since I completely destroyed that program, I can show you another program that this is B9. This is B9 creator. So this is another one that is very similar in terms of how the supports work. You know, again, I find that the Chitu one, the one earlier, what was I thinking? Oh yeah, it sticks to the model much harder than this one does. Basically, the supports for B9 breaks off easier, which can be a good thing or a bad thing. So that should be all the mediums I need. Light. Yeah, I mean, I think this is part and parcel of, how should I put it, working with like open source software and stuff like that. I mean, it's not always going to be super reliable compared to, say, a big company's product and software. But usually the community is really good and you can get a lot of help. So even though, yeah, I was like crashing the software, I'm not super bothered, you know. It might not be necessary. I think I'll just delete these two. Right, so I might move some of these around just to redo that cross support thing I was doing earlier. There's no undo on these things. And yeah, I can't actually select them. That's nice. Alright, so let's cross support right here. So far, I haven't had a lot of, well, in fact, I probably haven't had any real failures with support. So, I don't know whether I'm, you know, just overdoing, but it's fine. I'm just gonna do this just kind of like across the board. Cut right through these two long ones. I think that should be fine. This is a mess, and you probably aren't learning anything useful from this. What else is new? But yeah, so this is how I would support it, and so far that seems to work out. Gonna move these guys out a little bit just so that they have a little bit more of a kind of a flying buttress thing going on. Yep, that should do it. I think so far so good. Shouldn't be any sag. Sometimes like the really far lips like this will sag, but here. I think it looks fine. All right, so what I will do is export as this was left, wasn't it? No, this is right. What the hell? Okay, Okay. So I got to, I'm just gonna save this. Okay, so that's the left. Correct. Same thing, we'll just do the same thing. Right, so looks very similar. I hope it works. This is a bit of a gamble, but yeah, most of the time it works because I think this is more than I have placed in previous attempts, and previous attempts have worked. So if in doubt, add a few more. Really. Yeah, should be good. So we're gonna save this as so support's done. Okay, I think because the save file for BNI Creator cannot be the same as the STL file name. Stupid. Okay, we should be fine. Let's cross. Back to Kura. Yeah, the thing is that if everything went perfectly, if Cheetah didn't crash on me, if I didn't have this funny saving issue, I would have taken half the time. You know, this has taken me over an hour and a half. You know, how long's the stream? Yes, nearly taken me an hour to get to this stage when it shouldn't be. It's two pieces, right? But stuff happens, and this, I think this is, like I said, this is a very good example of, why is that? Okay, it's not completely inside. Okay. Okay, line. I'm still so having such phobia that they are exactly the same piece, and I was mentally rechecking if they were indeed the next same piece. Okay, so the thing about this is that there is a tilting function with the Peopoly Moai, and because of the tilting, like because you're doing a tilt, the furthest part from the fulcrum has a stronger peel force, which is the red area, and so it's better to put stuff on the green area first before you put stuff on the red area. Right, so I think this is that. So we'll let it slice now that I've finalized this. And that's it. Right, so it slices. I will save this out as a G code and I'll put it in the 3D printer. I just wanted to do this before we end. So I'm gonna end the stream here, and when I probably put this together as a video or something, I will show part of the printing process maybe here, but there's not much. It's like putting an SD card into the thing. So there. Okay, all right. I will see you guys in a bit.
I'll show you like a pre-printing process, because one of the things is that I leave the vat of resin inside the printer in between prints. You know, I don't empty this out. Oops. And one of the things that I gotta do as a result of that is because the resin is actually transparent with pigment, right? So one of the things that happens is that the pigment settles down to the bottom, and so one of the things that I have to do is kind of to stir this up a bit. So I have taken this out, so you can probably see much clearer what's going on. So you can see that the silicon film at the bottom gets a bit grayish, and that's just the pigment settling. So I got to kind of mix this up a bit, get rid of some of the gunk that's possibly from like previous filled prints. Oops, that's a bit of gunk. So this is a pretty messy process, I guess, if you this allows me to do a couple of things. I can check the condition of the PDMS layer, which is this silicon, transparent silicon layer, and I can look for any stray pieces that may have failed or fallen out in previous prints that I didn't notice. It's probably pretty obvious if you miss something. And actually, I don't have a lot of resin, so I'm gonna top this up, which is why I took this out. So this is probably good, and the PDMS layer has, you know, has oxygenated a little bit. This is the explanation the supplier talks about. You know, let the PDMS layer have some oxygen, and when that happens, you get like the adhesion will be better. So ran out of resin. Well, not ran out of resin. So this is, so far I've printed quite a lot of stuff. I've used about 500 milliliters of resin. So that's my first bottle of resin done. This is $35 worth of resin. So you can see this is the Peopoly UV resin gray. Yep. So,
yeah, cool.
So I'm just gonna mix the two, the new resin and the old resin, in together nicely. And this is sticky stuff, yeah, this becomes plastic. So it's pretty sticky stuff. Yeah, it's pretty sticky and it doesn't clean off. I mean, it's hard to use water to clean this off. Whoa. Right, so let's fire this up. I'm gonna bring the camera back a bit so that you can see more of what's going on. I'll turn that on. So it's a bit of a, oops. So it's testing the Z-axis, and the vat was moving a little bit. That's the really basic UI that you get. Print, select folder, G-code, and confirm print, yes. So at this point, I will have to put on my glasses. You see the surface go down. One last tilt, and the laser starts. And if everything goes right, this is gonna print out in about 6 hours. So we'll come back and see if that pans out. Next day, and print should be done. It's done. And the big reveal. So I can see more or less that everything seems to have come out the way I wanted it to. I'm gonna remove this. Alright, so you can see it's still dripping wet with resin. Which is, well, the annoying defining factor of resin-based printing. And it stuck to the build plate and it was upside down. So, if you can remember when I did in the software, I did this cone-shaped thing, and that this is the reason why I do it. Because I can do this. I can just pinch these things off and they'll come right off. Otherwise, if you make them flat, you know, you have to start scraping this build plate very rigorously, and that's not a good idea because eventually you'll wear the build plate out. So now I'm just using a little bit of mechanical advantage to pry these things out with. Well, there's some damage to the base, but minimal. Oops, well. Okay, so this piece is done. This piece is out. I'll just put it in a little Tupperware here like this. Don't worry if the supports are breaking off. I haven't decided whether it's a better idea to keep the supports on as I'm curing it or to leave it off. The jury's out on that for me. Because right now the piece is still a little soft. So I try not to touch it at all, and right, So give a quick wipe to this with a squeegee, just so that there isn't any leftovers on there. And I'm gonna put this back because, again, these are all the build surfaces and stuff. If I keep it in here, it will remain a little bit more dust-free. And so I have, well, this, which I will pour in IPA. So this is not a very pure IPA because I can see it's bluish tint. So this is my first wash of IPA. I'm gonna have a second wash of IPA. So this is the first wash to get as much of the resin off as possible. Oops, you can see there's a... The B9 supports drop off a lot easier than the one that I make the other software. And I'm not saying the other software sucks just because it crashed on me earlier yesterday, but these are, you know, software under development. They are open source software, and so they're not going to be perfect. So as it is, you can see very quickly that a lot of the resin has been removed from the piece. Yeah, I think I'll just take this opportunity to break off some of the supports. Right, so these are cleaned off. I'll put them in the second bath. So this is the first bath, which is pretty gunky, and the second bath. I'll probably have to pour in a little bit more. So right now they're in the second bath, I'll just leave this in here for a bit more to clean it out, and I'll give it a third bath of water. The final verdict of that particular print that I've been showing in the videos is that it wasn't really good enough. Because I'm not sure if you can see that there's quite a bit of warping on that piece. And so I've since had to redo it. And then what I've done is to actually add a lot more support at the bottom. So you see these are much thicker than what you saw. And so far it looks like, you know, even before removing the support, I can see that the warping is less on this piece compared to this piece. So I would say that that's a successful fix. It takes me a while to reprint, but I think this is all a learning process. And another solution I was trying was actually to extend this out and support it with the hopes that if there was any warping, this would be, it will warp on the extended part, and then I can just later to cut it. And while it seems that this works, this seems to be working as well. So you know, this is part of experimenting. I did the same piece. I failed to support that little corner, and so that's why there's a little bit of missing bad printing over there. But the end verdict is, yeah, supporting the middle. And another thing I've done is that I've done cross supports. I'm not sure if it's visible, but you can see that there is a support that's spanning from one side to the next of my print. So yeah, so hopefully that really helps out. Thank you. This is good to be learning on camera, and with all the problems that I'm facing, 3D printing is great, but it's not anywhere near perfect. Thank you.